Phase diagrams now. And this is going to be an area of the course that's much less computationally intensive. We're going to focus on the graphs, focus on the phase diagrams. So pay attention. Now I found the little 3D phase diagram thing in an STL file in Thingiverse. If you don't know about Thingiverse, Google it. Okay. And I'm going to print a little 3D phase diagram that I can pass around to class. And so I haven't got it printed yet because I was busy this weekend, but it's coming soon. So we've already talked about the standard definitions, but I want to put it in the notes so that you have it. All of these, most of these phase diagrams are going to be at SATP, so standard ambient temperature and pressure, so 298.15 Kelvin and 1 bar. Now, some of you may, from the freshman course, have memorized what the volume of 1 liter is, you know, at standard temperature and pressure at 22.4, but that's STP, 22.4 liters per mole, not SATP, it's 24.8. So beware using a number that you've memorized because the conditions may not be the same, right? So don't just, you know, make that mistake and say, oh, I know the volume of 1 mole is 22.4 liters, but it's not. That's only at STP. Now, most of our gas, our gas laws, they're focused on STP because it was easier to do the gas measurements, like Charles' law and all those different laws, Boyle's law, at standard temperature and pressure, because you can put something in an ice bath of E0C, but for the thermodynamic tables, we're at SATP, so 298 and 1 bar. Now, the nice thing about gases is that they behave ideally. Even non-ideal gases are mostly ideal, or they wouldn't be a gas, right? So vapor pressures, they're slightly less than ideal gas pressure. They've been adjusted, but we will still assume that the vapor above the liquid is behaving ideally. So just conceptually. Even though we know it's not the case, we are going to use the ideal gas law still to talk about the way gases mix, even above a liquid. So we'll treat steam as an ideal gas. We'll have liquid water and then the water vapor, and we'll treat it like an ideal gas, even though it's not. But what does an ideal gas do? Well, Dalton's law and partial pressures essentially applies to ideal gas mixtures, and that is this mole fraction of B when we have mixtures. So this is 0 B all the way up to 100% B. The opposite is A, so this is 100% A, 0% A. And so you have these partial pressures growing, and then the total pressure is just the sum of those. So the total pressure is the pressure of A plus the pressure of B added together. There's no interaction that A and B reacting and so on and making the total pressure lower. We're just going to treat these gases as if they don't interact, and that they bang into each other and they're elastic collisions. There's no condensation. So in an ideal gas, there's no condensation. Think about that. They never condense. No matter how high you raise the pressure, no matter how small you make the volume, an ideal gas does not condense. There's no liquid phase in an ideal gas. We know that's not the case. Right? If you increase the pressure and shrink the volume, you're going to form a liquid in real life. And so today we're going to talk about that condensation reaction and the PV phase diagram. Talks about condensation. This condensation occurs because we have this attraction region. So here's that figure again that I want to want you to have in your mind. Any kind of particles coming close together, there's going to be a region where they have attractions, and then when they hit, there's going to be this repulsion region. An elastic collision, they come in too fast to experience this attraction, and they hit, and the energy comes up here when they stop, and then they turn around and go the other way, and the energy is conserved. So that's an elastic collision. They leave with the amount of energy that they came in with. Now they may exchange it. You may have a small particle move, or a slow particle moving and a fast one hitting it, and it goes away with some of the speed of the first particle, but the total energy is conserved. You don't have anything lost in the vibrations of the molecule or the rotations. So we treat them just as hard spheres. But in real life, you have these attractions are dominant. So you have a molecule that is floppy, and it gets hit by a molecule, and it starts to vibrate. It doesn't go far away. It's like hitting a spongy thing. Like if you hit a sponge with a baseball bat, it's not going to go over the fence. It's going to absorb a lot of that impact and vibrations. Okay. And if it's sticky, it may stick to that particle and you may have attractions being down there. So here you got a floppy, sticky molecule, and another one hits it, and they condense. And so then, because it has enough of internal places to put that energy, it's got, you know, benzene rings hanging off of it and so on, and it absorbs that impact, and then the thing sticks together, and then you can have condensation. And so that's what we call like softer surfaces or softer collisions. We've seen Boyle's law, right? As you increase the volume, the pressure drops. Okay. If you have, how does temperature fit into this? Well, if you increase the temperature, pressure goes up at a given volume. And so these are all isotherms. And so we've been talking about isotherms. We could draw a Carnot cycle on here. This is an isotherm. This is an isotherm. And so the adiabats would be steeper, and they would connect these isotherms. So you could draw your little some parallelogram shape on here and make a Carnot cycle, I guess, but that's essentially these isotherms follow Boyle's law. But notice how no matter how much I shrink the volume, there's no condensation. It just follows these isotherms. This is what you would see with an ideal gas. This is not what you see in real life. In real life, you see this region where you have liquid forming. Now this is not actually a phase of liquid. This is a region where you start to see condensation. So let's walk along. This is a gas, and so as I shrink the volume, I follow this isotherm and the pressure goes up, and there's never any liquefaction because I have a high enough temperature. That's 50 degrees C for this gas, CO2. At 40 degrees C, I shrink the volume, following that isotherm, the pressure's going up. But right here, it's a little weird behavior, non-ideal behavior. It does this little wiggle, and then it goes up steeply. Okay. So the isotherm is no longer just this inverse relationship of pressure and volume. There's this strange little wiggle here. And right here, that wiggle actually goes flat. So the slope of that line is zero. And the curvature of that line is zero. So the isotherm has a spot, a critical point, and it's in this equation, like by using the terms of calculus, it's a critical point where the slope has gone to zero and the curvature has gone to zero. Because what's the curvature here? It's getting smaller and smaller, and then it's getting higher and higher. So the curvature passes through zero. It's an inflection point. And so the first derivative of this curve is zero, and the second derivative of this curve is zero. And that's how you find the critical point. So this is the critical point for this gas. The critical point is the lowest temperature at which you can maintain the gas phase. Anything below that, you're going to have condensation. Anything below that critical point, you're going to have condensation. But anything above that critical point, you won't have condensation. So it's this place where condensation just is a limit of the condensation regime. And you can see this whole blue area ends at the critical point. So temperatures above the critical point, you can't have a liquid. Temperatures below the critical point, you can have a liquid. At the critical point, I wouldn't call it a liquid. I would say it's just a very dense gas. And so that, and if you shrink it down, what's in this region here? At temperatures higher than the critical point, but yet volume's smaller than the critical volume, you get pressures higher than the critical pressure, that region right there is called the supercritical fluid. It's been crammed into such a small volume that it has the density of a liquid, but no meniscus. Like, how do you tell if there's a liquid in a vial? You look for the meniscus, right? You could cram a lot of gas in there, and if there's no meniscus, you would say, well, it's not a liquid in there, and you'd be right. But it could have the density of a liquid. Okay. You just wouldn't see the meniscus. And so that would be a supercritical fluid. Now that'd have to be a thick-walled glass, because most of the supercritical things are high pressure. But so below that critical point, then you have the possibility of forming a liquid. Now let's follow this one, this 20 degrees C. So here we are at room temperature. Let's say we have CO2 in a piston, and we're just cramming down on that piston. And we're compressing the gas, so what's it going to do? It's going to heat up. But we have it in a room that's 20 degrees C, and so that heat comes out. And so it's an isothermal compression. So we're cramming it in, we're doing work on the CO2. It's trying to heat up, but it's sinking the heat to the room, so it's following this isotherm. It stays at 20 degrees C. And when it gets to 60 atmospheres, we see a meniscus at the bottom. We start to liquefy some of that CO2. Okay. And so as we cram on that piston, the pressure doesn't change. The pressure stays at 60. This is atmosphere, 60 atmospheres. So if you wanted to do this in your notes, start here. Let's draw some pistons. So let's start over here. Let's start at B. Okay, B right here, we have a piston at the top. This is B. Strong container. So you have this volume at B, you've got a pressure that looks like 50. It's at 0.4 liters per mole. And so if you just had one mole in there, it'd be 0.4 liters. And so what are we going to do? We're just going to shrink that volume, push down on it. So then at C, coming down one further. Oh, I got a gap. Can't draw. So that's the volume, pressure. It's still a gas, okay, at C. We might have one little drop of CO2 liquid starting to form. So we have condensation. We have one little dew point drop of CO2. Now right here at D, we pushed that piston quite a ways in. We have CO2 gas, we have CO2 liquid. You see where D is? D is, we'll say 0.15. Liters per atmosphere. And we have at D about, in gas, is about the same as in liquid. So the number of moles in the gas phase and the number of moles in the liquid phase are about equal. Why do I say that? Look where D is. It's right in the middle. Okay? It's right in the middle between C and E. So what's changing as I go across this line? The only thing changing is the volume and the number of moles of liquid and gas. But the pressure is not changing. 60 atmospheres at C, 60 atmospheres at D, 60 atmospheres at 80. Right. So let's draw, this is D. Let's draw E.
Dr. Lee?
Yes?
Shouldn't it say 0.15 liters per mole?
Yeah, thank you. That's weird. Thanks very much. So at E, we're at CO2 liquid, 100%. And what is this? Maybe. We'll just say 0.05. Liters per mole. So we crammed it way down, and now there's no more moles of gas. So N gas equals zero. And then what happens if we keep pressing? We can still press on it. We can go to F. But look how steep that is. But we can do it. And mechanically, we can crank on that piston, right? And we can put hydraulics on it, and we can press that thing. And why is it so steep here? Look where we are. If I try to decrease that volume anymore, I can do it. But I'm going to have to pay the penalty. I'm going to have to push hard, right? The pressure goes up if I'm trying to squeeze a liquid. But I can do it. I can squeeze that liquid and decrease its volume. And that's the compressibility of the liquid, thermal compressibility of the liquid. So if I keep it on that same temperature isotherm, it's the isothermal compressibility of the liquid. It's a big number compared to a gas. Right? So the compressibility of the gas is easy. This is the slope of the gas that we were on. So this is the isothermal compressibility of the gas. The slope of that line is pretty small. This is the isothermal compressibility of the liquid. What if I kept pressing? It's not on this diagram, but if I kept pressing, what would eventually happen? What am I doing to the molecules? Think in terms of atoms, ions, and molecules. These molecules were free to fly around in the whole container here. They start to liquefy. What happened? They're held closer together. They can still slip past each other, right? If I keep pushing, what's going to happen?
Those molecules are going to get closer and closer and pretty much stick together.
Yeah, where are they going to stop? I mean, they're going to stop moving, but where are they going to sort of fall into place?
Into a solid.
Into a solid.
So you can just like compress a liquid and then enough and it'll become a solid.
Yeah. Just push on it. Let it sink that heat. Because you're pushing on the liquid, it's going to warm up. But if you let that heat come out, you keep it at 20 C, you just keep pressing and pressing. You can push it into a crystal. You just cram it down into a crystal. You can make it a solid just by pressing on it. Yeah. And then you would have a similar kind of tie line like this, where you've got liquid in equilibrium with solid, and you keep pressing, and eventually the solid crystals grow, just like the little drop of CO2 liquid grew until it filled the whole container. The little solid crystal would grow until it filled the whole container. And then I have solid CO2 in a tiny little volume, and the steepness of that slope would be another, you know, power of 10 higher. But, I mean, mechanics, we have strong equipment. We can push on the solid and just keep pushing on the solid until it might form a different crystal structure. So you can take like CO2 that's just T-shaped here, you know, in the crystal structure, and keep pushing until it slips into more like a tetrahedral shape, or go, you know, from like end on like that and slip into something that lines up. And so you can have solid to solid transitions and relieve that pressure. So you're putting enormous pressure on it and you can get a solid to solid phase transition. Now, what does that look like? Well, the new solid starts a little grain, and then that grain grows and grows and grows until it fills the whole container as well. Now, why is it doing that? Well, the new solid would take up less volume. And so as you produce enormous pressure, it's going to react by relieving that pressure. It's Le Chatelier's principle. You put stress on the system, and it reacts to relieve that stress. And so if I'm putting stress on the system by decreasing the volume, eventually it starts to liquefy. So it's relieving that stress by forming a phase that takes up less volume. And the liquid has got a smaller molar volume than the gas. And so then the whole container eventually fills up with liquid. And I'm pushing on the liquid, and it's relieving stress by being squeezed and giving up its heat. And then eventually the solid can start forming. The solid takes up less space than the liquid. In most substances, except water. Water's a weird one, okay? Yeah, so it has a slightly different slope, and so this water's a strange bird. But you can do it. You can eventually push on water hard enough to force it into a solid. And you have different phases of water. You have like four or so phases of water, solid water. So this is just walking you through these isotherms for CO2. Here's the real sort of data points here within Kelvin. So we've just walked you through just another nice phase diagram. Now, I included this one. I mean, this is the same kind of information. This is in Celsius. This is in Kelvin. That's not necessarily why I show you this one. Look here. So here's 334 Kelvin for the ideal gas. Here's 334 Kelvin for the real gas, right? So there is a difference in the gas phase between the ideal, treating CO2 as an ideal gas, you get this isotherm here, treating it as a real gas with the corrections, you know, to molecular attraction, you get this thing here. Okay. But notice how these lines get closer and closer out here in large volumes. And so that's where we justify ourselves in saying that CO2 can behave like an ideal gas, because most of the time we have an enormous volume that we're dealing with and a low pressure. Okay. You really see that difference between the ideal gas and the real gas at high pressure. So 100 bar, that's essentially 100 atmospheres. I don't think necessarily in atmospheres and bar, but I think in pounds per square inch, because I'm always filling up my tires, mm-hmm. Right? So 80 psi and so on. So 15 psi is one atmosphere, 14.7. Okay, so 15. And so 100 atmospheres is 1,500 psi. So that's pretty high. Yeah, so if we're dealing with a small volume, you know, let's say 0.1 of the, well, let's do half, okay. Half a molar volume. Actually, I want to kind of get up here in this 100 region. So this is a third. Okay, that's about putting one mole in 7 liters, a whole mole of CO2 in 7 liters, when at one mole wants to be in 22.4, so that's about a third of what a mole wants. So I got it in a third of the space that one mole wants, and I've got it at a pressure that's much higher, 1,500 psi. You know, it's going to react again. It's going to be close enough. Those molecules are going to be close enough to start experiencing their attractions. If I have that thing in a large volume, it's going to behave ideally, even at those same temperatures. We talked about the critical constants. Okay, so this is, if I take that CO2 and I look at the critical point, it's about 70 something atmospheres, 0.1 liters per mole, and 31.04 degrees C. So those would be PC, VC, and TC. So here we've got some subscripts. Those would define the critical point. Now every different gas has a different critical point. So these are sort of the properties of different substances. And here in about 4 weeks, you're going to do, 3 weeks because it's spring break, you're going to do what's called the Maxwell Construction Lab, which deals with this kind of phase diagram. And the critical points are important for that. But I wanted to focus on something really amazing, and that is an engineering principle called unitless temperature, unitless volume, and unitless pressure. Like, what does it mean, unitless temperature? That's the one that always freaked me out. It's like, this equation is in unitless temperature. And it just, you know, I could just just feel one of my old neurons going, because I did not know what the heck that's supposed to be, right? They should have said relative, and it would have made sense. You know, relative temperature, relative pressure, relative volume. But, and then I would have said, okay, it's relative to something. What's that relative to? We're dividing by something. And so you can take the pressure, temperature, volume of gases and divide by the critical pressure, temperature, and volume, and you get unitless pressure, temperature, and volume. And then those are relative values, relative to their critical points. So let's have some fun here. So look at hydrogen. It's pressure, it's PC, VC, and TC. Yeah, we have time. Okay, look at all that. Here's your critical constants, all right? And let's skip ahead to this chart right here and see that ethene, ammonia, here's methane, here's hydrogen. They all have this different behavior of the ideal gas law, this compressibility factor, based upon their properties of their gases. But if you take all of these values and divide by their critical points, look at this, they fall on the same line. What? Nitrogen, methane, propane, ethene, very different gases, and yet they're all on the same line. And so we can take gases and divide by their critical points, and they behave the same way. So a gas that's twice its critical point will behave the same way as this gas that's twice its critical point. But the critical points could be so different. Like hydrogen's critical temperature is 33 Kelvin, and ammonia is 406 Kelvin. But if I have ammonia at 800 Kelvin, it will behave like hydrogen at 60 Kelvin. And hydrogen and ammonia are totally different. But now you see why engineers love unitless temperatures. Because they have tables of critical constants. And they have these equations based on unitless temperature, pressure, and volume. And all they got to do is, to put hydrogen on that, they just divide hydrogen by its critical points. And they know right where it'll be. And ammonia, divide by its critical points, and then they know right where it'll be. And so there's a little question in here that you can look at. So get your mind around this. I love this. Okay, so that means you should look at it. So look at this little diagram and see if you can figure out what's going on here. We'll talk about it next time.